from the meeting room. It's set in Bahrain in 2003 in the run-up to the invasion of Iraq. And it's about a young missionary couple who go out there as the white things to further Christian ties in an Islamic country. But on the evening that they arrive, her husband confesses to her that he's lied to her about the purpose of the trip, that he's involved in something a bit more sinister. This sends her into a sort of spiral, and she questions her marriage and she questions her faith, and she ends up having a love affair with someone else. So here we go. He has come to Bahrain to smuggle Bibles into Saudi Arabia. There you go, I've sort of spoiled the suspense of the first two chapters now. there are other revelations. He's come to Bahrain to smuggle Bibles into Saudi Arabia. Not smuggle, he objects. That makes it sound like drug running. What then? Introduce, bring in, please, Ruth. He has closed his ears. Don't get hung up on the word. It's not alcohol or drugs or illicit substances or what have you. It's bringing the word of God to those who are dying of thirst for it. He shows her the gospel. It is the gospel of Matthew with a Sermon on the Mount, printed in a tiny font on rice paper, fragile and flimsy as the veined skeleton of a fallen leaf. The paper is rolled into a tight tube, thinner than a pencil, and inserted into the body of a cheap biro, branded with the logo of a construction company or engineering firm. He has a whole box of the pens, 100 of them. He carried them over in her suitcase, along with a carton of cheap pamphlets about the fictional Northern Irish business. You, what? She can barely form the words. You and you. She tries again, words fail her. She gapes at him the whole way. In their luggage, alongside their books and clothes and Anna's toys, the whole time? He tries to take her arm and she pushes him away. So violently, she almost topples over. Please, Ruth, he says, I'm begging you, please, hear me out. He kneels on the floor in front of her. He actually kneels. And she feels too sick and stunned to stop him. He will make the trip across the Caldwell, he says, along with another man or men, ostensibly for the purpose of meeting with Saudi-based companies. There are networks in place to distribute the gospel. It must be done before Easter. He led you through the vast and dreadful desert, he recites, that thirsty and waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. You, and she interrupts, but he continues, his voice is thin. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the desert, something your fathers had never known, to humble and to test you, so that in the end it might go well with you. We must pour water on the thirsty land, Ruth. Her mind is starting to whirl with questions. You need a visa to get into Saudi Arabia. You can't just cross the border. It's the strictest place in the Middle East. You need a company to sponsor you, a visa from the state. Even I know that. And what about the fake company you're supposed to be representing? Surely all it takes is a couple of phone calls or a Google search to see they don't exist. He tells her he cannot go into details, that even he does not know the details. They keep them secret until the last minute, even from him, until the last possible moment, in case the plan is discovered. They, she says, she's almost shouting out, they, who are they, Ewan? He doesn't know their names, not all of them. But trust me, Ruth, these people, they're not amateurs. But you are. That's different, he tells her. They always meet new people, new faces. You cannot make more than one or two crossings. Your face becomes known. And it cannot be people who've lived out in the Gulf. They become known too. One or two crossings? Are you out of your mind? It's illegal, Ewan. It's worse than illegal. It's against Islam. It's blasphemy. It's the worst crime possible. They still cut off people's hands in Saudi for stealing a loaf of bread from a market store. They stone people to death. They cut off people's heads. What if they catch you? What if it goes wrong? And what if it had gone wrong on the way over here? And they found the she casts about for work, the material on us. Us, you and your wife and baby daughter, us. Please, Ruth, he begs again, please. But she moves away from him, puts a divan between them. You brought us, she says, struggling to keep her voice level. You brought your wife and your daughter into this country, knowing that's what you were going to do. With all the talk of war, he counters, and hostilities to the Western world and Christianity running high, it is more important than ever that they support the struggle of their underground brethren in places suddenly more unsafe and more unstable than ever. Support, she says. It's not support you, and it's not the same as coming to Bahrain to help with the church. It's an illegal act that could get us all thrown in jail, that could get you killed. All this time, feeling her voice start to crack, you've been playing fast and loose, not just with your life, but with ours too. But it's not just our lives, he says. That's the thing. It's far, far bigger than that. It's the eternal lives of tens of people, hundreds of people who will otherwise burn in hell. It is far more than a matter of life and death. She does not know what to say when he says that. She stares at him. His face is pale and set, like a death mask of itself, and his eyes are gleaming. Ruth, he says, get away from me. So that's when things start to go wrong. the second passage that I'll read is Ruth has this ambition to go and visit the Tree of Life in Bahrain. It's this old acacia, thousands of years old, and it exists in the middle of the desert where nothing else can grow. So obviously there are the parallels with the Garden of Eden and all these sort of stories. She had imagined the journey to the Tree of Life as a sort of pilgrimage, a long, bumpy drive through the desert, a beautiful desert with mile upon mile of sand dunes, like ripples of silk, and a spice-scented sky. She had imagined arriving at dusk and walking the last few hundred meters to the massive, gnarled old acacia, which even modern carbon testing methods admitted to be thousands of years old. A living thing, older than Christianity, it was almost inconceivable, a vital relic from another mythical time. She had imagined the tree would radiate a sense of this, an air of dignified benevolence, an acknowledgement of the memories of all the people through the centuries, through the millennia, who had sought solace in its shade, of Adam and Eve themselves even, resting from the heat of the day. She had imagined lying against its rough, hoary trunk and feeling life flowing to her mysteriously, like the flow of water from the hidden spring so deep beneath the earth. She'd imagined going with Ewan, even when he laughed at the idea of together feeling their confirmation about renewed. She had not imagined this journey, a short drive with two teenagers she barely knew, because Farid was a teenager, it had transpired. He looked older in his thobe and gutta, but he was still 19, his 20th birthday in a few weeks' time. And she had not imagined arriving like this. The road to the Tree of Life ran so close, you could drive right up to it. Rusting pipes snaked across the scrubby earth, which was littered with tufts of spiky grass and clumps of gorse bush. To the left of the tree, only a short distance away, was a massive used car scrapyard with heaps of scorched metal and tires piled 40 or 50 high. About half a kilometer to the right was a big oil refinery, erupting clouds of tarry black smoke. When Farid pulled up and they climbed from the car, Ruth saw that the grey ground was covered with bottle caps and crisp packets, Coke cans and beer bottles, the charred remains of makeshift campfires and shreds of plastic sheeting. The great tree itself tilted to one side, apologetic or ashamed, its heavy boughs drooping towards the earth, the branches on its right-hand side crawling almost abjectly for several meters before making a half-hearted attempt, rising up and breaking into leaves. The low metal fence that surrounded the trunk offered scant protection from the gangs of teenagers who liked to come here, Ruby told her, to build fires and drink and smoke weed. The tree trunk and larger branches were covered with their graffiti, names, dates, banal obscenities, written in spray paint or marker pen, scraped in viral or hacked roughly with a penknife. The lower branches were mutilated, stripped bare where people had snapped off twigs as souvenirs. She walked around the tree two or three times, slowly. Noor had unbuckled Anna and was squatting down with her and drawing patterns with a stick in the dust, for Reed was leaning against the car smoking. It was almost midday now, and the sun was at its highest. The light had a glassy sound, as if it shrieked faintly as it shimmered. She felt hollowed out, as if someone had taken a blunt instrument and gouged out her inside. A gourd, the goodness gone, left to dry in the sun. It was meaningless. She knew that now. All she had, all she was. It was meaningless, chasing after the wind. Man's fate truly was like that of the animals. The same fate awaited them both. As one dies, so dies the other. All have the same breath. Man has no advantage over the animal. All go to the same place. All come from dust, and to dust all return. Her vision was blurry and dizzy. She bent forward. Ruth? Farid was behind her, beside her. She tried to speak. She could not speak. She felt tears prickle her eyes, and before she could do anything, stop them, blink them back, they were spilling out and down her cheeks, more and more of them, rivers of tears. Ruth! Farid's voice was coming from very far away. His hand was on her back, stroking, moving in firm circles, as she might do to Anna. Ruth, Hamdullah, what is it? What is it? She straightened up, lacuna still pulsing at the edges of her vision. I thought I'd find something, she found herself saying. I know it's ridiculous because the Bible isn't literally true. I mean, not even you and another soul. And it's not that, it's just, her voice began to break down on her again. I thought if I could see where things started. And she stopped, dissolved into tears. Farid had hold of her shoulders, was using the sleeves of his robe to wipe her cheeks. Then all of a sudden, she was embracing him, falling against him, into him, clinging, as if once she let go, she would plummet. And Nora was there too. She could hear her, but she couldn't stop crying. She couldn't stop crying. Thank you very much.